Professor, what is something that most physicists believe that you think is completely wrong?
Well, there are several things of that nature. I think probably the most blatant one is the cosmology model I have. You see, most people who believe, who normal cosmologists these days, believe that the universe began with the Big Bang, and there was an early phase called inflation, and this phase was supposed to have smoothed the universe out. I never believed that. It doesn't make sense, because why does it work in one direction and not in the other direction? I mean, you get crazy singularities in black holes, which are not automatically smoothed out by time-reversed inflation. It doesn't. It's okay. Most cosmologists believe in inflation. I don't believe a word of it. Mm-hmm. But this is just part of the story. You see, the story which I have is that the Big Bang was not the beginning. That the universe goes through cycles. The cycles start with each one starts with its own Big Bang, terminates with a remote future. You see, this is the thing you have to understand, is that the scheme at both ends, the conformal structure of space-time is the relevant thing. Conformal structure, to get an idea, it's useful to think of these Escher pictures with infinity, see angels and devils, and they crowd out along this circle boundary which represents infinity. And this is a conformal representation. Now, the same thing applies, I claim, to the universe as a whole. And our remote future is a situation, you see, I'm arguing that there are two times, if you like. One, at each of these times, mass becomes irrelevant. One of them is at the Big Bang. Mass becomes irrelevant because the temperature gets so high that the particles move around so fast that the mass contribution becomes trivial. I mean, the main contribution is the kinetic motion, and the actual rest mass of the particles becomes less and less important the closer you get to the Big Bang as you go earlier. So that's a situation in which mass becomes irrelevant at the beginning. And another place where mass becomes irrelevant for a quite different reason is in the very remote future. And then, I won't go into the reason in detail, that sort of shifted with for my early arguments, but the massive particles, the mass term scales in such a way that it becomes irrelevant in the remote future. Certainly Dirac particles, and the Dirac particles will be the main particles, apart from photons. Photons are already massless. The other particles mainly will be Dirac particles, electrons, positrons, maybe protons, but maybe they decay. Doesn't matter which. They're still Dirac particles. And they will, if you write them in the right way, you can see that they scale out, and so they become effectively massless in the remote future. And so those two ends, the mass disappears. Now, when you don't have any mass, you don't have any scale. The geometry is really what I call conformal geometry. Well, it's not what I call it. Mm-hmm. It is conformal geometry. And the conformal geometry, it means, well, like those Escher pictures, you preserve angles. The angles are clearly defined and make sense and unaffected by getting close to the edge of the picture, whereas the sizes are changed. So conformal geometry is the geometry of angles, if you like. In space-time, it's the geometry of the light cones. So you have the null cones, I should say. The null cone gives you 9 out of 10 components of the metric. The 10th component really is the scaling of the whole thing, and that is given by the mass. The scaling of the mass comes from the two most famous formulae of 20th century physics. One of them is E equals mc squared, and the other is E equals h nu, hf, if you like, due to Planck. So the Einstein E equals mc squared and the Max Planck E equals hf or h nu. Put the two together, and that tells you that frequency and mass are equivalent. You see, the energy is one energy is the other. So frequency and mass are equivalent. So that mass is what gives you the scale. So it determines the frequency, you see. If you don't have any mass, you don't have the notion of frequency, then you don't have scale. So you have conformal geometry. And the two places you don't have mass, I argue, is in the remote future, because the Dirac particles is all that's left and they scale away, and the Big Bang, where you have energy so great that the mass becomes irrelevant. So for quite different reasons. But then the argument is that then a remote future, from a conformal perspective, is very like a stretched-out Big Bang. And the reason for this perspective is that the Big Bang is extraordinarily special in the sense that the gravitational degrees of freedom are not activated for some reason. And this isn't explained by inflation. It's not explained by any conventional cosmology. However, it is explained if you say that the Big Bang is a conformal continuation of the remote future, because you find that the scale, the gravitational degrees of freedom scale away. It's a little bit of a subtle question, because gravity has two different scalings. One of them goes away and the other one stays with you and enables gravitational signals to get through from one side to the other. But anyway, that's a scheme which I think there's a lot of evidence for, but people pay very little attention to it. And certainly it's not the majority view is to have a Big Bang and inflation and all that stuff. So that's perhaps the main example where I hold a different view from most people. Another place where I hold a different view, I think, has to do with the collapse of the wave function, which I believe is a very important phenomenon, but you see, there's no common view on that one, I think, you see. With the cosmology, there is a common view that the Big Bang was the beginning, and for some reason, trying to be argued that inflation was the reason, but it doesn't really work, that the uniformity of the Big Bang, which distinguishes it from the incredible complication that you expect for singularities in black holes. They're so utterly different in nature. So you need some explanation for that. The other element has to do with the collapse of the wave function. But there isn't really a common view, I think, that is held by most physicists. I'm not sure what most physicists think. They usually sweep the problem under the carpet, I think, as far as I can make out, without recognizing it's a serious problem.
So two of the other problems that inflation solves, one is flatness that you mentioned, but two of the other ones are the uniformity of the CMB, so the horizon problem.
Well, the fact that you don't have gravitational degrees of freedom. I mean, people don't sort of recognize that very well. I don't know. I found it very puzzling, because the expectation inside black holes, of course, we don't know what goes on inside black holes, but the expectation from independent calculations from a Russian group, Belinsky, Lifshitz, and Kolatnikov, and Charlie Misner in Princeton, and they have pictures of the complicated situation that you get as you get close to the singularity, and it's very complicated. You find curvatures go wild and in different directions, and one direction takes over, and then another one, and it's very complicated. Nothing like the Big Bang. I don't think people think about the problem, really. It's not that they have a different view from me. They have a different view, but they actually don't face up to the real problem. They have this belief somehow that inflation solves the problem, which is, in my view, completely wrong.
Where does that belief come from?
The fact that you don't have this kind of singularity in the Big Bang. And so the belief has to come from somewhere. And so the inflationary point of view seems to be that's all they can think of, I suppose. I don't know. I mean, it's very commonly believed inflation is part of a standard cosmology.
The Economist covers math, physics, philosophy, and AI in a manner that shows how different countries perceive developments and how they impact markets. They recently published a piece on China's new neutrino detector. They cover extending life via mitochondrial transplants, creating an entirely new field of medicine. But it's also not just science. They analyze culture. They analyze finance, economics, business, international affairs across every region. I'm particularly liking their new insider feature. It was just launched this month. It gives you, it gives me, a front row access to The Economist's internal editorial debates, where senior editors argue through the news with world leaders and policymakers in twice weekly long format shows. Basically, an extremely high-quality podcast. Whether it's scientific innovation or shifting global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage beyond headlines. As a Toll listener, you get a special discount. Head over to economist.com/TOE to subscribe. That's economist.com/TOE for your discount.